welcome everyone to St. James with a special service called Special Lives. We are here because we have all shared experiences of losing our loved one, yet for each of us that experience will have been different. Some of us here are newly bereaved and pain is still raw. Some of us have lost loved ones some time ago, but still wish to remember them publicly. For some, our loved ones were snatched away suddenly or too young. For others, death was a release from a terrible suffering or came peacefully at the end of a long life. All of us here are wanting to remember, and we have come here because it is in God that our future and the future of our loved ones' lives, and in God that strength and comfort can be found. Here is also a good place to remember, because church is a safe place to bring our feelings and emotions, and where we don't have to be afraid of them. As part of the service, we will be naming all those who you've asked us to include. God's love is the same, of course, whether someone's name is read out or not, and it may be that you have come with a loved one on your heart. We have made every effort to include all the names given to us, and I apologise in advance if anyone is missed out accidentally or through circumstances unforeseen, or if even I pronounce anyone's name wrongly. Tonight I will light a candle on your behalf due to the COVID regulations, and you have been given a candle to light at home in memory of your loved one, and cards have been designed for you to take home by Janet Woodworth and made by Carol Hilly, members of St. James' congregation. The Lord is here. We need not fear.
The Spirit is with us.
We are surrounded by love.
The Spirit is with us.
We travel in faith.
The Spirit is with us.
Truly, the Lord is here.
Spirit is with us.
come to you with our thoughts, memories, and prayers. May we know the comfort that only you can bring, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gracious God, we place ourselves in your presence. Our minds and our spirits are cluttered. Help us to make space for you. Help us to be fully present here now, as we say. We release to you all that we have done today, whether for good or for ill. We release all that we feel like we should have done today, but did not do. We release all of the people who weigh on our hearts and minds this evening. We release our fears. We release our anxiety. We release our impatience. We release our pride. All of the thoughts, all of the feelings that pull us away from you, O God, we release. And now, with open hearts, we receive what you offer us now. We receive the gift of this space and this time. We receive the gift of being each person here. We receive the Holy Spirit's presence with us for guidance and healing. We receive the sacred words that will be spoken and thought. We receive the holy touch of hand and heart. We receive the silence. We receive the music. Fill us now with peace of your deep abiding presence. We offer all of ourselves to you, our one God, creator, redeemer, sustainer. Amen. The almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon and forgiveness of all our sins, time to change our lives, and the grace and strength of the Holy Spirit. This is a reading from Psalm 22, verses 1 to 5. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer by night. I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you our ancestors put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. Psalm 22 echoes Jesus' last, in English, 9 words on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? The psalm begins with the psalmist agonizing for being forsaken and alone, yet ends with praise and exaltation of God. In his book, The Hope of Glory, historian John Meacham writes, light in the darkness, life from death, rescue from tribulation. Such are the promises of Psalm 22 and of God the Father. It is hardly surprising that the rawest of words from the crucifixion should perhaps tell us of the most divine meaning of the cross, where Jesus recurved the worst of humanity's violence and hatred. He turned them around by transforming it into the manifestation of an indescribable love, agape love. It was truly light in the darkest of moments. And even though Jesus felt forsaken, he never was. He brought life from death, love and forgiveness in the face of the worst. Tragedies are largely perceived as individual circumstances. But in this time, the world is living the same tragedy, and many people have lost loved ones during this time and because of it. Where funerals should have been full of treasured people, restrictions have meant they couldn't be. More loss on top of loss. So how do we cope, cry, call out, and care? How can we ease our anxiety, alarm, and angst? David Kessler and Elizabeth Kubler-Ross have been the scientists and doctors behind the psychological studies and books on the five stages of grief. And I would like to look at them as a foundation for assessing our own grief and circumstances. You may see yourself in any of these stages, and that is okay and it's normal. Some people move through the stages in different order, others do not experience every stage, and that is fine as well. The first stage is denial. On the Kessler-Kubler-Ross website, grief.com, it states that denial is the first of the five stages of grief. It helps us to survive the loss. In this stage, the world becomes meaningless and overwhelming. Life makes no sense. We are in a state of shock and denial, and we go numb. We wonder how we can go on. If we can go on, why should we go on? We try to find a way to simply get through each day. Denial and shock help us to cope and make survival possible. Denial helps us to pace our feelings of grief. There is a grace in denial. It is nature's way of letting in only as much as we can handle. As you accept the reality of the loss and start to ask yourself questions, you are unknowingly beginning the healing process. You are becoming stronger, and the denial is beginning to fade. But as you proceed, all the feelings you were denying begin to surface. When these feelings surface, the first emotion that is most recognized is anger. And anger is okay. In fact, it is necessary. This anger can extend to your family, friends, strangers, petty annoyances, and painful moments. It extends to the even God and sometimes the vicar. It is this anger and frustration which causes Jesus and each of us to ask why. Why, God, have you forsaken us? This anger is a way of naming our loss and love of what has come before. Isn't it comforting to know that Jesus felt this too? But from anger we may then bargain. Please God, if you will change these circumstances, I will and you can fill in the blanks yourself. We can become lost in a maze of if only or what if statements. We want life returned to what it was. We want to go back in time. Which of us does not want to make that happen right now? Who among us has not wished some person or government or God did not step in sooner to stop this virus or stop our loved one dying? We what if ourselves and others, but we realise this bargaining is of no help at all. This can bring on the fourth stage, which we recognise as depression. Dr. Kessler says, after bargaining, our attention moves squarely into the present. Empty feelings present themselves, and grief enters our minds on a deeper level, deeper than we ever imagined. This depressive stage feels as though it will last forever. It is important to understand that this depression is not a sign of mental illness. It is the appropriate response to great loss. When this loss fully settles in our souls, the realization that the life we had is not coming back, it is understandably depressing. In our current world, we still do not know how much of a pre-corona world we will have back or with. These stages of grief can also apply in our lives for this time. If grief is a process of healing, then depression is one of the many necessary steps along this path of healing. The sadness and emptiness in our lives and souls will not go away for a long time. With this realization will come the fifth stage of acceptance. Acceptance may be confused with the notion of being all right or okay, but this is not the case. E-condolence says, acceptance does not mean that the person will feel good or right about the loss. Most people never feel okay about the loss of a loved one or their own impending death. This stage is about acceptance of the fact that this is a new reality. It is about seeing how the new reality will impact life and relationships. In this present pandemic, we will never feel okay about the loss of all these human lives. We will never accept the pain of economic despair. It will never be okay to be unable to hug grandchildren or miss funerals, to not celebrate an important event such as a wedding. We will never like this reality or make it okay. We will accept it for the moment. Acceptance never means we will forget either. Acceptance means embracing the present, both good and bad, in order to shape the future. But we will always remember and cherish those precious memories with our husband, wife, parent, friend, grandparent, family member, or even a child. Life has forever changed. In the accepted stage, roles and responsibilities begin to be altered. New priorities may be shaped. New relationships will need to be formed, and some duties and tasks may need to be given up for someone else to handle. Good Friday leads to Easter Sunday. Hope is where we live and know. The promise of Jesus Christ, who says, I am with you always until the end of time. We do not know what the future will look like, but we can have fresh eyes to new possibilities. These stages of grief are not linear or time specific. Each day, we can even go through all five: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. It may help you to know that I've been bouncing between anger and acceptance in the last few days. Life continues, but never the same. But always enriched by our loved one's presence, ever pressing towards hope. Life has been changed forever, and we can adapt and grow around grief. As a church family together, we are always here for you, even when the doors must close for worship and only stay open for private prayer, Emmanuel on a Saturday, 10 till 12, and here on a Monday, 10 to 11. And we're still here to be in touch with. So let us go forward as in this time, using the words of Psalm 121 as our affirmation, where it says, I lift up mine eyes, my fresh eyes, to the hills, from where will come my help. My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Richard Jenkinson, Alice Jenkinson, Janice Candelan, Lorraine Tez, Margaret Lee Taylor, Jim Rowan, Stanley
in memory of all your loved ones, those named and those in your hearts, we light the Paschal candle.
So let us call to mind those we have named out loud, those we have remembered in our hearts, and all who have been an important part of our lives. When we are weary and in need of strength, when we are lost and sick at heart, we will remember. When we have a joy we long to share, when we have decisions that are hard to make, we will remember. When the storms rage and we feel the chill of winter, when the buds are opening in the freshness of spring, we will remember. When we see the blueness of the skies and feel the warmth of summer, when we hear the rustling leaves and the world is painted in autumn colours, we will remember. At the rising of the sun each morning and at its setting every evening, we will remember. Let us pray with confidence to God, our Father, who raised his Son from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that we may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Strengthen and deepen our faith. Help us to use wisely the rest of the time we have on earth, and make us ready when you call us to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, be close to those who mourn, deepen their faith in your undying love. Make your presence known to the dying, strengthen them with hope and fill them with peace. Support those whose work to bring healing and wholeness to the sick, and care and comfort to the dying. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Have mercy, Lord, on those who live with fear, uncertainty, or anxiety. Be with those tonight who are sick, hungry, homeless, or afraid. We pray also for those whom we love, at home or far away, and for all whose lives are closely linked with ours. We pray for all of our families that we may not be able to see at this present moment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for all those who have gone before us and have been an example to us. We pray that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to join in with the words of the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus himself taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, may God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and in the next, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, and with all those you love and care for, both living and departed. Amen.